Welcome to St. Peter Lutheran Church. We're so glad that you could join us today for this fourth Sunday of Easter. We're continuing in our celebration of that first Easter Sunday, rejoicing in the resurrection of Jesus as we remember those first witnesses of the resurrection, how they got to see the risen Christ and spread that message to all the people that they knew, while at the same time recognizing that we are God's witnesses today too, that God has put his words in our mouths so that we can be his messengers in this world. But we also add to that a special extra layer today, because today is not only the fourth Sunday of Easter, it is Good Shepherd Sunday. Jesus uses that image over and over again in Scripture to remind us what kind of a Savior he is. He's that tender, loving shepherd who cares for us, but he's also that fierce protector who provides for us and shields us from harm. So today we blend these two concepts together and see that the Good Shepherd guards his messengers. We'll see how that plays out in our gospel lesson and in our lesson from Acts chapter 6 today as well. But before we get into any of that, we'll open the same way that we always do with a song. We invite you to join along in singing with Keith and Kristen Getty. Thanks to them again for making their resources available. We'll sing along with them Across the Lands. Dear friends in Christ, we worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins to Him, asking Him in the name of our Good Shepherd to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin. For faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do, you should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. In His great mercy, God made us alive in Christ even when we were dead in our sins. Therefore, hear the word of Christ through His called servant. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. O Lord Jesus Christ, you are the good shepherd who laid down your life for the sheep. Lead us now to the still waters of your life-giving word, that we may abide in your Father's house forevermore. For you live and reign with him and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our gospel for consideration today is taken from John chapter 10, one of the many pictures that Jesus paints for us of him being our good shepherd, this one focusing mainly on the access that we have, that he grants us through his gate. We'll see what that means in these first 10 verses of John chapter 10. Jesus says, "Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice." Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." This is the gospel of our Lord. We'll continue with our hymn of the day, hymn 375, "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." We'll sing four verses of hymn 375.
Yeah.
Sermon text for today takes us to a couple chapters of Luke's book of Acts, chapters 6 and 7, where we're introduced to the first Christian martyr, Stephen. We see a glimpse of who he is and hear a short portion of the brief sermon that he preached, but we'll talk more about who Stephen is and what he means for us after we read from Acts chapters 6 and 7. In those days when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and to the ministry of the Word." This proposal pleased the whole group, so they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. Now Stephen, a man full of God's grace and power, performed great wonders and signs among the people. Opposition arose, however, from members of the synagogue of the freedmen, as it was called, Jews of Cyrene and Alexandria, as well as the provinces of Cilicia and Asia, who began to argue with Stephen. To this he replied, "You stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You're just like your ancestors. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestors did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you've betrayed and murdered him, you who have received the law that was given through angels but have not obeyed it." When the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." At this, they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he fell on his knees and cried out, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he fell asleep. This is the word of our Lord. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, Stephen is a very interesting character study in Scripture. We really don't know a whole lot about him. Almost as quickly as he appears on the pages of the Bible, he is gone. But the lessons that we learn from him last quite a bit longer. When Luther wrote his commentary on this section of the Bible, he had a pretty apt way, a concise way of summarizing it. Luther said, "You have pictured here, in this story, the entire gospel. Faith, love, cross, death, and life." I thought that's a pretty good way to summarize exactly what was going on in Stephen's life, and it might be a helpful way for us to process what his example means for us. So let's start with faith. Luke tells us in Acts chapter 6 that there was a problem in Jerusalem, that certain people were being overlooked during the distribution, the daily distribution of food. It wasn't intentional. The apostles were on it as soon as they realized it. So they selected 7 men to make sure that this would never happen again, but with a stipulation that these 7 men all had to be known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom, so that before we even hear Stephen's name, we know that he's full of the Spirit and wisdom. But then, 2 verses later, when Luke finally introduces Stephen to us, he doubles down on that description of Stephen, and he describes him as a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. Luke is going out of his way to help us understand Luke is a very faithful man. He has great faith in God, which may make you wonder that this is the first time that Stephen's name is ever mentioned in Scripture. How did he get to be so faithful? How does a guy who has a Greek name come to be one of the 7 who's chosen to help the apostles in their daily work? We may never know the exact answer to that question, but generally speaking, it's the same way that any of us come to faith. Paul reminds us in Romans chapter 10, faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. So whether Stephen was an initial follower of Jesus from the very beginning or only came to faith later on in life when the disciples came and found him and told him about Jesus, it doesn't matter too much because the result is going to be the same. Stephen heard the word, the Spirit worked in his heart, and he believed. He didn't look to Jesus as an earthly king, a lucky charm, or a sage on a stage. He saw Jesus as he rightly is, as the Savior of the world, and as our hope for heaven. Stephen had this faith in Christ, and it made a difference in his life. It wasn't like this little nugget of knowledge that he could tuck away in a corner of his brain somewhere only to be retrieved when he needed it again. His faith in Jesus was alive and active, and as Luther would point out here, it inspired Stephen to love, which is a good thing because there was a distinct lack of love being shown in Jerusalem. As I mentioned before, and as we read a few minutes ago, there was a certain segment of society that was being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. The believers from Greece lodged a complaint against the local believers from Jerusalem. So we had this local group of people who all knew each other, who were already taking care of each other, but who had developed a habit of overlooking the newcomers, the outsiders, the people who didn't necessarily fit in. It's not uncommon for that kind of thing to happen today, is it? But that's where Stephen and the 6 other men come in. They were eager to serve. They weren't apostles. They weren't tasked with going out and preaching the gospel or teaching the people. As Luke says here, their job was to wait on tables, which was in no way a demeaning task that was below the apostles. It was a very necessary act of love and compassion, a way to show their care and concern for people who had need. Which is why when the disciples selected these 7 men, it was important for them to be full of the Spirit and faith. Because the disciples then, they could have done the same thing that you and I could do today. They could have pooled all their resources and hired out the care of these widows to somebody else. But it wasn't just about putting food in mouths. It was more about showing love. It was about putting the needs of others ahead of their own. It was about equipping men like Stephen to be able to go and serve people who had need, to go and serve God by serving others. And that's why Stephen and these other six men had to have faith to start. Because love flows out of faith. But faith can also have another consequence. Luther calls it the cross. We might call it problems, trouble that arises because of our faith. Jesus warned his disciples that this kind of thing would happen. He said that his disciples would be persecuted, they'd be handed over and put to death, that all nations on earth would hate them because of Jesus. And again, he said, if they persecuted me, they'll persecute you too. And that was that's what was happening to Stephen. He was a great guy. Stephen was a man who took care of old ladies. He was a model citizen who did wonders in the community. A portion of Acts chapter 6 that we didn't read for today even describes him as angelic in appearance. There was no earthly reason to hate Stephen. But opposition arose against him anyway. And what really irked the people was that Stephen was unafraid to speak about Jesus. Now remember, Stephen believes that Jesus is the Savior. That's who he is. But how can you talk about salvation unless you also talk about the thing from which we are saved? If Jesus is our Savior from sin, then you have to talk about sin too. Then you have to talk about the ways that you and I mess up, the wrongs that we commit, the good things that we fail to do, the commandments of God that we break, the way that we don't measure up to God's perfect standard. And that's a big deal because there's punishment and penalty that comes along with that. But Stephen's audience didn't want to hear it. I'm sure you've been in a similar situation. Maybe it's even happened to you that somebody comes to you and points out a failing on your part. And what's your first reaction? Isn't it to deny and put up those shields of defense against those accusations, maybe all the while kindling a fire in your heart of anger and hatred toward that person? It's embedded in our human nature to get defensive when somebody accuses us of something. It's so very rare that our first reaction is to admit that we've done something wrong and ask for forgiveness. Much more often we attack and accuse that other person, even if they were trying to help us. And that's what was going on with Stephen here. Stephen was telling the truth. What he said was 100% true, but the Jews didn't want to hear it. They were being stubborn. They were resisting the Holy Spirit. They were not listening when God spoke to them through their law, and they were actively rejecting the people that God sent to preach that law to them. And even most recently, they murdered the Messiah that God sent to save them. The Jews didn't want to hear it. So like 5-year-olds, they covered up their ears and they yelled at the top of their voices and they rushed at Stephen to stone him. The cross that Stephen was shouldering now, this trouble and difficulty because of his faith, was quickly turning to that next stage of a Christian's life, which is death. Luke tells us that these men dragged Stephen out of town and began to stone him. They killed him in one of the most violent ways imaginable. They threw rocks at him until he died. But even in that moment, Stephen demonstrated how rooted he was in his faith. Some of the things that Stephen says while they are in the act of killing him sound very similar to what Jesus said while the Romans were in the act of killing him. Stephen didn't hate these people. He didn't curse them. He didn't wish them any harm while they were killing him. In fact, he did the opposite. He, with childlike faith, entrusted his spirit to his Savior and then asked that same Savior to forgive the people who were killing him. Stephen became the first Christian martyr, the very first person recorded to die specifically because of his faith. And to us Christians, Stephen becomes a hero, somebody that we can put up on a pedestal and look up to and admire and try to be like. But the problem with heroes is that the more we look at them and the more we strive to be like them, the more painfully aware we become of how far we fall short. And as I think about these four stages that we've talked about so far, faith, love, cross, and death, I have to admit that I'm nowhere near Stephen's level. I have faith by God's grace. I believe in Jesus, but that's a gift that God gives. It's not something that I have earned. I've been privileged in my life to have Christian parents who brought me up in the faith, to have Christian pastors, good godly men to lead me all my life. I have that privilege. I didn't do anything to accomplish it. I can't claim any credit for it. Like anyone who believes, that's a gift that God gives us simply from hearing the word. It's where my faith that God gave me, it's where my cooperation with that faith comes into play that the wheels start to fall off. Because I don't always love other people the way that Stephen loved the people of Jerusalem. To my everlasting shame, I overlook those who need love, and I've lost sight of those that I am not only able to, but called to serve. So rarely as bold as Stephen was, but rather swallow my tongue when the occasion arises to speak of Jesus because I'm afraid of being rejected or ridiculed for speaking my faith. And as hard as it is to say that, maybe it's not fair because I've had time to think about that. And all week as I've prepared a sermon on this text, I've thought about ways that I can articulate that to you and couch it in comfortable terminology. But if you came to me on a random day and accused me of any of those things that I just admitted to you, I would probably react just like the Sanhedrin did. I wouldn't want to hear it. I'd raise up those walls of defense and plug my ears and yell at the top of my voice because I don't want to listen to another second of how far I fall short. I mean, Stephen was a great Christian. And his story gives Christians hope, but not because of the actions that Stephen did. It's not as if he lays this template for us to follow and then become like him. I don't think I have the strength of will to just become a better person, and even if I did, that wouldn't change what I've done in the past. No, our hope doesn't come from Stephen's actions. It comes from the confidence that God gave to Stephen, that he expressed in the words that he spoke just as he was dying. Like the prayer that he asked his father, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Do those words sound familiar to you? They're very similar to what Jesus said while he was hanging on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. In Jesus' case, he was most definitely referring to the men who were pounding nails through his hands and feet. But he was also speaking to all those people whose sins made his death necessary, Jesus was praying that prayer of forgiveness for you with some of his final breaths. And with that last breath on the cross, Jesus ensured, achieved, earned your forgiveness. See, Jesus is so selfless that in his love for you, he was willing to take on all of the accusations, all of the crimes and penalties and punishments that you deserved. He was willing to be accused of all of them and to claim them as his own and to die because of them so that he could forgive you for the times that you are stubborn and defiant and defensive. Jesus loved you so much and was committed to you so much that he boldly and courageously walked to the place that he would die so that he could forgive you for the times that you lack the courage to even speak his name. Jesus loved you so much that he was willing to die at all so that you could live, so that you could be forgiven of the times that you fail to show love to the people around you. Jesus loved you so much that he died so that God would not hold your sin against you anymore. He died to forgive you all your sin and remove all your guilt. He died to give you the confidence that he gives to Stephen here. Did it strike you as strange that at the introduction to our service today, I said the theme for our worship is the Good Shepherd guards his messengers, but then we read this long story about how one of his messengers gets murdered? What kind of shepherd stands idly by while his sheep get slaughtered? Well, it's not exactly the scene we see here, is it? Because in the last moments of Stephen's life, God gave him a special revelation. Stephen looked up to heaven, and he saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Jesus wasn't sitting, sipping a cocktail with slippers on a recliner, unaware and unconcerned with what was happening in Stephen's life. He was standing at the ready, at the right hand of God, the position of power and authority, ready to act and to continue to guard and protect his special sheep. And even though Jesus didn't step in to spare Stephen's life in that moment, he did still answer Stephen's prayer. Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. That's what good shepherds do. They lead their sheep to green pastures with quiet waters. This is the ultimate promise that your good shepherd makes to you, that he will ultimately lead you to those green pastures, the paradise of heaven. He promises you that there is life after death, that there is a resurrection from the dead, that even after you die, you will live because of Jesus. And all the while that you are living, Jesus is not distant or disinterested. He cares about you. He's watching over you. He's guarding you and protecting you. And even if, God forbid, some tragedy should befall you and your life ends in a way like Stephen's did, Jesus stands at the ready to receive your spirit, to welcome you into his eternal home. That's why even after describing this horrible death in Acts chapter 7, Luke writes so gently, when Stephen said this, he fell asleep. For Christians, death is only temporary. Death is only that gateway to the eternal life that Jesus has prepared for you. Even after we die, we have the promise that we will wake up in heaven with Jesus sitting bedside, smiling down on you and ready to usher you into the home that he's preparing for you even now. There are a lot of things that may or may not unfold in your life. We don't know what obstacles are going to come, what threats may come. We may not all end up like Stephen did here, but every Christian's path is the same. And the promise that God gives every Christian is the same that God gives to Stephen here. Jesus is with you every step of the way, from faith to love to cross to death to life. Jesus is standing at the ready to guard and protect and provide for you, and is waiting to bring you to your heavenly home. That's the confidence that your good shepherd gives to you. Now may we be like Stephen and be people who are full of faith and the Holy Spirit, who relish the opportunity to read and hear God's word so that the Spirit can work faith in our hearts, who exercise the love that God inspires in us through the love that he has shown to us, so that we can carry our crosses with confidence and go to our deaths without fear, because we know that we have life everlasting in Jesus' name. May we always be ready to see and recognize Jesus guarding and protecting over us as our good shepherd. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, on this Good Shepherd Sunday, remind me how you do not send me as your messenger of the gospel into this world to be alone and helpless. You are by my side, guarding and keeping me. Nothing can snatch me from your hand. Guard my heart and faith. In my good shepherd's name I pray. Amen. And we also pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We close our worship today by singing hymn 432, I Am Jesus' Little Lamb. concludes our worship for this morning. We're so thankful that you could join us today and so honored to share God's word with you. If you want to find out more about our ministry here at St. Peter's, you can do so at our website, stpeterlutheran.com. You can see it on the screen that will follow this. We also encourage you to stay tuned to these live stream services because we'll continue to make use of them as long as we have to. A good way for you to do that is to subscribe. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel so that you don't miss any of these special services to continue to meet your needs while we're in these days of self-isolation. Which makes me think about some of the pieces of news that we've heard over the last couple days, how economies are beginning to open or plans and phases are being unrolled. I want to assure you that we're keeping our ear to the ground. We're going to be prepared for that when it comes, but we also want to be patient as that happens and not act too quickly. We have this opportunity to continue to worship together, and we'll continue to make use of it until it's safe for us to return and to enjoy each other's company in a space that we can call our own. We look forward to that day, and we're eagerly expecting and preparing for that. In the meantime, we do have a couple things that we want to make you aware of. We have a Bible class today on 1 Peter chapter 2, where we'll talk about the relationships that we have with other people in a time of suffering and uncertainty. But we also have the second installment of a new Bible class. We started last week on Wednesday. It's a study of the end times. So what can we expect about the future? What does the end of the world look like? This week, we're going to look at especially purgatory and life after death and what that whole process is going to look like as the Bible tells us. Otherwise, we have our normal weekly schedule. We invite you to join in our prayer group on Wednesday noon. We have confirmation class this week as well. Again, if you want any other information, you can subscribe. You can become part of our mailing list. Lots of ways for you to stay informed. Otherwise, that's all I have for you today. We'll begin our Bible class at about 11 o'clock. That's when I'll open up the Zoom meeting, but we'll start our session at about 11:15, just to make sure that you can all log in on time. But that's all we've got for you today. God's blessings on the rest of your week.